أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما أما بعد يقول صلى الله عليه وسلم in the authentic hadith the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says اجتنبوا السبع الموبقات avoid the seven destroying or destructive sins. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was asked, O Prophet of Allah, what are these seven sins that cause one to or lead one to destruction? The Prophet ﷺ began to explain, starting with ash-shirk, meaning that to associate along with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or to worship another entity aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to dispose in whole or in part any act of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated in the Quran or in the Sunnah. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the Prophet ﷺ and of course rest of the believing ummah. وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ It was revealed to you, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, as it was revealed to all the prior prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if you were to commit shirk in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, irrespective of how great your deeds are, irrespective of how many your deeds are, irrespective of how long you worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that all of these deeds would be wasted. لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكْ means all of your deeds will be wasted and you will receive no credit whatsoever, no reward whatsoever on Judgment Day. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says at the end of the ayah, وَلَتَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ which leaves no doubt in the mind of any individual, any Muslim whatsoever, that this act or this sin, which is committing shirk in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will waste one's deeds and will land them in the hellfire for eternity. This ayah is echoed in many other places in the Quran, along with the ahadith that the Prophet ﷺ says, one of which we just mentioned, and along with the ruling that the Prophet ﷺ has established, where he says, mujibatan, two obligatory acts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has vowed, you know, to commit to make come true. مَنْ مَاتَ يُشْرِكُ بِاللَّهِ دَخَلَ النَّارِ Whoever dies in a state of shirk shall for eternity perpetuate in the hellfire. And whoever dies in a state of iman shall enter paradise irrespective of their sins once upon a time. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could choose to forgive this individual and enter him into paradise immediately. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if this individual did not repent from these sins, could punish him first and then enter him into paradise later. Now the danger of shirk is of course the very element or the very foundation of our deen is at-tawheed. And the Imam of Tawheed, as we mentioned before, is Ibrahim alayhi salam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna Ibrahim kana ummah qanitan lillahi hanifan muslima walam yakun min al-mushrikeen. That Ibrahim alayhi salam, the father of most of the prophets, was a true Muslim, a Muslim that is on the hanifiyya, meaning that deviating from anything to do with shirk whatsoever, and upon the straight path, upon the path of tawheed. To the extent that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described him that Ibrahim alayhi salam had the qualities and the characteristics of iman that is sufficient for an entire ummah. To the extent that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded his seal prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to follow his footsteps, as he says, ثُمَّ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ أَنِ اتَّبِعْ مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ حَنِيفًا وَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ Then, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, we have revealed to you that you follow the millah of Ibrahim, is the way of life, the way of worship that Ibrahim عليه السلام has followed. حَنِيفَ, staying away and clearing your path from any state of shirk, any shirk ibadah, upon the straight path, which is the path of tawheed, and that is the path that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has taught us to follow. Now, I will give you a couple of examples of how our ignorance sometimes could land us in a state of shirk without us knowing. one sacrifice that a couple in this local area, without mentioning any names, that I've made, they spent $1 million+ in establishing a home, a house for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning that a masjid. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be worshipped, and the Quran can be recited, and the dua can be established, and so on and so forth. This very individual, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him abundance of wealth, but he did not pursue a path of knowledge. And as we mentioned before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts not a ibadah that is not based upon knowledge. And that's why the first words that were revealed in the Quran, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. We can never underestimate or exaggerate the significance of these words when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to read by the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق, the one who created. Seek a path of knowledge. Apply this knowledge to your daily life, to your way of life, to your sharia, to your ibadah. So this individual didn't have much knowledge. But in spite of the fact that he was able to establish this masjid, he wanted to be the leader. We know in Islam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qasas, إِنَّ خَيْرَ مَنِ اسْتَأْجَرْتَ الْقَوِيُّ الْأَمِينَ, that this deen is about kafa'ah, about competency to lead, competency to perform the work, competency to establish the masjid, competency to run the masjid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, the second element, which is trustworthiness, that you are trustworthy, that we have given you this trust over the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only place of tawheed on the face of the earth, the most important place on the face of the earth, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Nuh, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا, that these masajid, once they've been established with my money, with your money, with the community money, with the Muslims' money, they now belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't belong to anyone else. So no one can say, this is my masjid, I own it, I have a share in it. No. وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا, do not supplicate to anyone with or aside from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these masajid or any other place. So this individual, obviously, a notion came out a few weeks ago, and he decided to be that, quote unquote, moderate Muslim. I don't subscribe to that opinion, but these are the words that were used. And he began establishing a library where he put the Islamic books next to the Christian books, next to the books of Judaism, under the pretense of interfaith. Now, what is a greater level of shirk than to teach that one is three and three is one, and to respect that and to accept that? Or to accept those who've assassinated the prophets and the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those, not only they've assassinated his messengers, they also fabricate lies against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, the All Supreme. To put these books next to the books of Tawheed, where is the knowledge? Where is the understanding of Islam? Where is the common sense, if you will? And then invites khatibs, those who give public speeches, be it during Salatul Jum'ah or during the halaqat or any of that. And these khatibs are telling people it's perfectly okay to supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the deceased. And it's perfectly okay to make sujood towards the grave. And emails are circulating around, which is very alarming, is that Muslims are doing extensive research to find out if what he said is true or false. What have we been doing all our lives? Tens of years we've been Muslims, practicing the concept and the ideology of Tawheed. And then we have to go back and research to see if it's okay to make sajda in front of the grave, to see if it's okay to supplicate through the deceased. What have we been doing? Yani, subhanAllah, I don't want to, you know, speak extensively about this subject, because you think this is among the very basic fundamentals, you know, of Islam, that each and every Muslim, young, middle age, and old, has got straight. And there is no issues with that. But subhanAllah, these issues keep on resurfacing, which is only an indication of the level of ignorance that is prevalent in the Muslim Ummah. Wal'iyadu billah. So the first of which, among these grave sins, is sab' al-mubiqat, al-shirk. Okay? The second of which, قَتْلَ النَّفْسِ الَّتِي حَرَّمَ اللَّهِ, to kill a soul unjustly, without just cause, particularly the soul of the believer. And subhanAllah, what we witness now, you know, everywhere, that the souls of the believers are being killed left and right without just cause. by the enemies of Islam and by those who are undercover pretending to be Muslims trying to establish the truth, and by those who have political agendas and by those who have religious agendas and so on and so forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَنْ قَتَلَ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمُ خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَلَعَنَهُ اللَّهُ وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَلَعَنَهُ وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا. So just to understand the weight of such a crime, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever deliberately kills a Muslim, فَجَزَاؤُهُ جَهَنَّمْ خَالِدًا فِيهَا, his punishment is the hellfire wherein they shall perpetuate. وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry with him. وَلَعَنَهُ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curses him, means he expels him from his mercy, means that there is no mercy for this individual. وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا, and he has prepared already, the punishment is prepared, عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا, a tremendous level of torment, a tremendous punishment for this individual. Now just words of caution, خَالِدًا فِيهَا, the scholars say this is for those who look at killing a Muslim as something permissible, not those who kill a Muslim knowing that this is a grave sin. Okay, for those there is punishment. And also, the ruling in this ayah, according to some scholars, that if one is to repent, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them so long that the repentance is sincere. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives that which is even greater than killing the soul of a believer, which is shirk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives shirk, as he says in Surah Az-Zumar, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله إن الله يغفر الذنوب جميعا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. Oh my devotees, my slaves, do never despair from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgives all sins, but that requires sincere tawbah, fulfilling the conditions of tawbah, to cease the act, to regret it, and to resolve not to go back to it. And if you can rectify the injustice that has been done to an individual when there's a third party involved, then you must do that at once. So in this case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive, but the ayah remains in the Quran to show the gravity of such, you know, horrendous crime to kill the soul of the believer, to the extent the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us in the hadith that the sanctity of the soul of a believer is greater than the sanctity of the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the most sacred place on the face of the earth, that is Mecca. So we can imagine the sanctity of the soul of the believer. But here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, keeps this ayah, if you will, abrogates the ruling, and keeps this ayah in the Quran to show that as a warning for us not to, you know, lightly engage in such, you know, acts. And also in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لا يزال المسلم في فسحة من دينه ما لم يصب دما حراما. That the gate of, or the door of tawbah, repentance, is wide open for the believer, so when they are alive, until or unless they kill unjustly. When they kill unjustly, the gates of tawbah begin to shrink. And of course, depending on the level, you know, of the crime and how many they've killed and what are, you know, circumstances, you know, surrounding that, so on and so forth. So the first of which is a shirk. The second, actually, to mention them in order, we mentioned the third one, to kill a soul unjustly. But the second one actually in place is a sihr, which is black magic. Practicing black magic is an act of shirk. What is black magic? Magic in general is characterized to mean that تخيل يعني شيء للعين, means that the eye is seeing something that is not true. Means that the eye is being tricked to see something. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يعني in Surah Taha, فَخُيِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ مِنْ سِحْرِهَا أَنَّهَا تَسْعَى. So they began to see the ropes and the sticks that the magicians of the Pharaoh, you know, has performed. They began, people around, they began to see these as things that move, the things that are doing things. So they're not seeing it at its true form. The only one who sees it at its true form is the magician. Because the magician, they see what's going on, they know the tricks of the trade, so they're doing that. So the way they do this, of course, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَسَحَبُوا أَعْيُنَ النَّاسِ, means that they what? They trick the eyes of people. They did not change the facts. They tricked the eyes of people to make them see that which is not true. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Harut and Marut. So, magic is an idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught to people because we live in a world of trial, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught, the idea of, using drugs. Making drugs out of plants, or making alcohol out of grapes, or, technology. It's an idea that's in the mind of people, but here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing everyone. He's saying, this is my legislation, this is what you can do, and this is what you cannot do. That's why in Surah Al-Baqarah we read, وَمَا يُعَلِّمَانِ فَيْتَعَلَّمُونَ مِنْهُمَا مَا يُفَرِّقُونَ بِهِ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ وَمَا هُمْ بِضَارِّينَ بِهِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ. Something important to keep in mind. If a person wants to cause you harm, this person can prepare themselves to cause you harm by a weapon, whatever the weapon might be, or any other instrument whatsoever. Now, they've made that decision, they've made their mind. Now, their ability to cause you harm or not to cause you harm is subjected to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subjected to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mention this because oftentimes when Muslims hear the word magic or black magic, they go frantic. Okay, but something to understand, which is in the Quran, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us, that these magicians who use the help of Satans, be it the Satans of the jinn or Satans of the people. We cannot see the jinn because it's a creation that has been created from the tip of a flame. So these magicians, they use the help of, these Satans, these jinn. And of course, to use their help, you have to practice blasphemy. You have to commit shirk. You have to commit kufr. Sometimes you have to disgrace the Quran. Sometimes you have to fabricate lies against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in order to use their help. In other words, you're paying a price for that. Now, these jinn, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مِنْهُمَا مَا يُفَرِّقُونَ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ. And they learn from them that which they put between a husband and a wife. How do they do that? They use the jinn. So when the husband looks at the wife, the jinn takes the form or the shape of an extremely ugly person, or an extremely deformed person, or a scary person. So they're playing tricks on the eyes of the husband, if you will. So therefore, the husband, when he looks at his wife, he sees something scary. He doesn't see his wife the way she is. He doesn't see her beauty the way he used to see her. So now that causes him to what? To distance himself from his wife. And the opposite can happen as well, where the woman can observe her husband in such a scary way that she does not want to be with him anymore. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا يُفَرِّقُونَ بِهِ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ, that they would put apart between the husband and the wife. But here's what's important now. Just like we mentioned the example that one who's carrying a weapon can only cause you harm to the extent that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permits. Similarly, a person who is practicing magic can only cause you harm to the extent that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permits. And that's why he says, وَمَا هُمْ بِضَارِّينَ بِهِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. They cannot inflict harm on anyone except with the will and the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us in the Quran and in the Sunnah that which protects us from black magic. Between supplications, between surah in the Quran, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, the ayat that talk about magicians, the ayat that talk about black magic, so on and so forth. All these ayat that we can use to fortify our iman and to protect ourselves. Similarly, the ad'iya, the du'a, even to the extent Satan himself, who is the head of all the Satans, cannot have any influence over us because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانِ. My slaves, my devotees, you have no power whatsoever over them. So long that we stay close to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we stay close to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even Satan himself cannot do anything to us. This is us as believers, that's what we ought to, have a strong iman and practice all these supplications, recitation of the Quran, just like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the hadith, for example, اقرأوا البقرة فإنها لا تستطيعها البطلة. Recite Surah Al-Baqarah frequently, because the batala, means that the magicians, those who practice magic, cannot overcome this one. They cannot overcome this one. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, gives us the ammunition, if you will, to fight back and to protect ourselves. And not to be paranoid by this magician and this jinn and this. That's just a lot of nonsense that people who have weak iman are always preoccupied with. I repeat, people who are always preoccupied with the issues of jinn and satans and magicians and so on and so forth, these are the people of weak iman. They have left, you know, major parts of their deen and they focus on that which harms them. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is on your side. And nothing takes in His universe, in the dominion of the heavens and the earth without His will. Nothing takes place without the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the second one. The third one which we mentioned, killing a soul unjustly. And I will add to that also where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لا يحل دم امرئ مؤمن إلا بثلاث. It is not permissible to shed the blood of a Muslim except three conditions, and I'll mention that ijmalan, collectively. So there are a lot of details there. An-nafs bil-nafs, one who kills another soul. Wa-thayyib, unjustly that is, of course. Wa-thayyib al-zani, one who is married or has been married and commits adultery. Wa-tariku li-deenihi al-mufariqu lil-jama'a, one who abandons his deen and abandons the Muslim ummah or the Muslim group and begins to cause fitan, tribulations. Okay? So that's the third one. Again, I'm just mentioning things collectively. There are a lot of details behind this that we need to understand. But here we're just talking about the hadith collectively. So that's three. The fourth one, aklu riba. You know, dealing with riba. And riba by definition, anything that is an increase, that's considered an increase above the original loan. In other words, if I give someone a $100 loan and they return it to me a year later, 101. That one is riba. Now some people will argue inflation. You know, it's like trade. It's this, it's that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala settled this issue in the Quran by saying, وَأَحَلَّ اللَّهُ الْبَيْعَ وَحَرَّمَ الرِّبَى. He made trade, buying and selling, dealing and wheeling, permissible. And He has made riba prohibited. الْحَلَالُ مَا أَحَلَّهُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَالْحَرَامُ مَا حَرَّمَهُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. That which is permissible is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has made permissible. That which is prohibited is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has made prohibited. It is not for a believer to question as to why. What the believer needs to understand is the wisdom behind that. Before we get to the wisdom, I want to mention the threat and the warning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the Quran. Where He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتقوا الله وذروا ما بقي من الربا. All you who believe, have taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and abandon, put aside, leave alone that which has left from riba, which you used to deal with in the days of Jahiliyyah, when the riba became prohibited. Some Muslims were still dealing with riba until this ayah was revealed. فإن لم تفعلوا, and if you do not cease at once, فأذنوا بحرب من الله ورسوله. Meaning that, be prepared to wage a war against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And on Judgment Day, the scholars say that those who deal with riba, right, they'll be swimming in rivers of blood. And they will come to the shore, and then somebody will be standing there, one of the angels, and will throw a rock at them, and it lands into their mouth. And they would go and swim in this river of blood again. And on Judgment Day, they are told to take their weapon and be prepared for a fight with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there is no such a thing as 5% is okay, 10% is okay, you know, 1% is okay, no. If we look at the wisdom behind the prohibition of riba, we see that the one who's taking a loan, why are they taking a loan? Because they're in need. In other words, they do not have the money to sustain themselves or to find a job, or to get a, you know, establish a small business or any of that. So that's why they're asking for a loan. They don't have the funds to begin with. So imagine those who are in need, and sometimes they borrow out of necessity, which is just to fulfill their basic day-to-day necessities. They borrow, and now you loan them $1,000, and you come back and you ask for $1,200, or $1,100, or $1,500. They don't even have the original loan that you've given them. And the one who's given the loan certainly had, you know, the original loan and had more beside that, because that's, in other words, what they have is above what they need. above the necessities and above the needs, and sometimes above the luxuries as well. So that's why they're given the loan, you know, in the first place. So here there is, you know, a form of usury that disrupts the relationship of the community and the ummah at large. Is that the needy is being abused. Is that, in other words, I'm going to give you a loan because you're in desperate need, and not only I'm going to ask for it back, I'm going to ask for it back and more. So it's a form of slavery. It's a form of slavery. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets for us the right course of action for those who borrow money out of need or necessity, where He says, وَإِن كَانَ ذَا عُسْرَةٍ فَنَظِرَةٌ إِلَى مَيْسَرٍ. If you give somebody a loan, and there's still the time for the loan has come to mature, if you will. It's time for you to fulfill that loan and to be paid back. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن كَانَ ذَا عُسْرَةٍ. If they're still experiencing hardship, financial hardship, then you ought to wait. Do not put undue pressure on them. Do not abuse them. Do not, you know, take a legal action, if you will, against them. You ought to wait. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't stop there. He says, وَإِن تَعْفُوا فَهُوَ أَقْرَبُ لِلتَّقْوَى. If you forgive the loan, now you're closer to taqwa. You're closer to the element that's going to make you achieve success in this dunya and in the hereafter. This is Islam. So imagine you come to a person who borrowed money from you, and say, when the time of the loan matures, and he says, you know, I really want to pay you, but I don't have the money. So don't worry about it, I've forgiven the loan. Can you imagine now what happens? How the bond and the unity, you know, comes, you know, together? This person is no longer feeling any negative feelings towards you for having money. And he's probably making supplications for you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses you, blesses your family, blesses your wealth. Versus a person who is being abused, doesn't have the basic needs, you know, the basic necessities of life, and you come and you're trying to basically, you know, use and abuse this individual and put undue pressure on them to repay that which they don't have. Are they going to be happy and for you that you have wealth? Are they going to supplicate for you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless your wealth? No. So you can understand the wisdom behind the prohibition of riba. Now someone could say, well, you know, how do we conduct business? You know, we need to start our business. There's something in Islam called murabaha and musharaka. I don't want to go into details, but it's a form of partnership where one enters a partnership with their money and the other one with their expertise. Or they make some sort of a deal where they share it to the Prophet or any of that. So there are many forms for those who wish to establish a business and they don't have, you know, the money. Okay? So these are four. The fifth one, akl mal al-yatim. To basically unjustly, and see here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He uses the word eating, you know, eating riba, and eating, you know, mal al-yatim, which is the wealth of the orphan. An orphan is a person who lost his father before reaching the age of puberty. A person who lost his father before reaching the age of puberty, meaning that the one who was sustaining him, the one who was providing for him, is no longer existent now. So now, it's really incumbent upon the society, you know, to take this orphan, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, أَنَا وَكَافِلُ الْيَتِيمِ هَكَذَا, in paradise. That I am, me and the one who sponsors an orphan, and he points with his two fingers, means that equal in reward on Judgment Day or in paradise. Which is tremendous encouragement to take care of these, you know, orphans, who basically have lost, you know, their fathers. And, you know, again, the wisdom behind that, of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives severe warning for those, you know, who take, you know, the wealth of the orphans unjustly. And He says in Surah An-Nisa, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ الْيَتَامَى ظُلْمًا إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا وَسَيَصْلَوْنَ سَعِيرًا. That those who eat the wealth of the orphans unjustly, in their bellies they are eating fire. And on Judgment Day, they shall taste the punishment of the hellfire. وَلَيَادَ بِاللَّهِ. So there's tremendous warning of, you know, unjustly taken from, you know, the wealth or the money of the orphans. And a fine example that Al-Khidr sets for us in Surah Al-Kahf, when he explains to Musa alayhi salam why he erected that fence, he said, وَأَمَّا الْجِدَارُ فَكَانَ لِغُلَامَيْنِ يَتِيمَيْنِ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ وَكَانَ تَحْتَهُ كَنْزٌ لَهُمَا وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا. As for the fence or the, you know, the wall that I've erected, underneath it there was treasure, you know, there was wealth for two orphans. So it's practicing, you know, birr, if you will, which is the highest kinds of treatment, you know, in preserving and protecting the rights of these orphans by erecting this fence, even though nobody paid him anything for it. So he's basically, you know, taking responsibility for protecting the wealth of these two orphans, and that's what the society ought to do. So this way, when the orphan grows, he has something to rely on. And when this orphan, you know, his father dies, he doesn't look at other children and become envious and start looking at them with some sort, with some negative feelings and hardships that you have a father, I don't. So when this person is taken into, you know, custody, if you will, you know, the custody of those who are going to sponsor this orphan and take care of him, he's not going to feel envious or jealous towards those who have fathers. And he's going to grow up to be a healthy member of the society versus an orphan who's been deprived from his, you know, from his rights, and he's been used and abused, and then is going to be grow up to be, you know, an ill member of the society with a lot of hardships or with a lot of hard feelings. So that's the wisdom behind that. The sixth one is قذف المحصنات الغافلات, meaning that to accuse. Of course, this goes really for both men and women, but in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, you know, addresses women, means that to accuse women of committing adultery. Muhsanat means that their state of ihsan, they're chaste. Ghafilat, they're oblivious, unaware of what's going on around them. Just like what happened to Umm al-Mu'mineen, Aisha, radiallahu anhu Allah. And this was a tremendous lesson for the believers back then and throughout the history, you know, thereafter, where, you know, a man was basically being, you know, on the custody or on the welfare of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu ardaha, you know, accused Aisha, Umm al-Mu'mineen radiallahu anhu ardaha, that she committed adultery in one of the battles when she was left behind. And Aisha radiallahu anhu ardaha did not know anything about what's going on, but she saw that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has changed, his treatment has changed towards her. And people in the town are talking about her, and she had no idea what was going on. When she learned, she lived in a state of misery for almost an entire month until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in the Quran her innocency. So you can imagine how much hardship and how much havoc such false accusations can, you know, shed in the society. She was the talk of the town. She was the talk of the town. The hypocrites capitalized on that, and they began to accuse, Aisha radiallahu anhu ardaha, yani one of the most pure women to walk the face of the earth. They began to accuse her of adultery. Can you imagine the state of mind and the stress that the Prophet ﷺ himself lived under? Number two man, Abu Bakr and his wife have lived under. And of course, the doubts that Satan comes and throws in the minds and the hearts of people. You know, she's being accused, she's the talk of the town, she must have done something wrong. Okay? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed a punishment for people who engage in such sinful behavior, that is 80 lashes, and their testimony is never accepted. Meaning that they've lost their credibility, and their testimony is never accepted again. So this is number six, you know, last but not least, At-tawalli yawm al-zahf. Meaning that when the two camps, the Muslims and the non-Muslims, are fighting, people who withdraw from the battle without just cause, to draw from the battle with just cause, meaning that you're late because you're preparing yourself for the fight, or part of a war strategy, if you will, that you are, you know, realigning your roles, and this is up to the leader of the military, is that you can basically reassign people to the different groups because it's part of the strategy and the tactics of war. These are two exceptions, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says so in the Quran. But as for those who, when the two camps or the two militaries are facing one another and they withdraw, the gravity of the sin that they're committing, number one, is that they are raising doubts in their own minds and the minds of the weak believers, that, you know, if they die, they're at a loss. But we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that it's never the case where a believer who fights fi sabilillah is at a loss. Meaning that إِحْدَى الْحُسْنَيَيْنِ, he's going to receive one of the two. Either shahada fi sabilillah, to achieve martyrdom in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those who achieve that status, which is the highest status ever for any human being to achieve, you know, after the prophets and the messengers and the siddiqeen, that's the highest status that anyone can achieve. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ يُرْزَقُونَ. Do not think that those who die in a state of martyrdom are dead. Means that even the earth does not eat their flesh. They do not decompose. Their body does not decompose. They're not washed. They're wrapped up in the garments that they wage jihad fi sabilillah. They're wrapped up in that and they're buried in that. And they are in a state of life. Means that they are living in the company of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they're in a state of overjoy because of that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon them in terms of the rewards and in terms of the pleasures and in terms of that which they receive, you know, in paradise. So this is the first one. The second one, of course, is victory. Is that one is going to achieve victory. And of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأُخْرَى تُحِبُّونَهَا in Surah As-Saff, وَأُخْرَى تُحِبُّونَهَا نَصْرٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَفَتْحٌ قَرِيمٌ. And another one that you love, and everybody loves victory, نَصْرٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ, a victory from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَفَتْحٌ قَرِيمٌ, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make this deen grow even to a larger extent, and will strengthen Islam and the Muslims. So these are the seven mubiqat. Of course, these are not the only, you know, great sins that we've been warned against, but these are the seven that are mentioned in this hadith which are of utmost gravity. And these are the ones that we need to learn more about how to avoid them. Learn more about how to avoid them, because certainly you don't want to be praying and fasting and giving your zakah and performing your hajj and all of that, and oblivious to that which would cause your deeds to be wasted, to receive no credit for. هذا والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Thank you.